So good day, everyone. I'm really excited. Today we have a session all about the colors of stars, and I'm really pleased to invite my friend Tom Field from Seattle, who is going to tell us a lot of the art of star colors and how to show this and what we can learn from it. Tom, welcome.
Thanks, Christian. I'm happy to be here. What a great group and a wonderful series that you do here of videos on iTelescope.
Well, thank you. We are really happy that we can get such good speakers. We've been extremely lucky, and we've also had a very tolerant audience and very inquisitive audience. So, Tom, go ahead, please.
Great. Well, thank you, and welcome everybody. And for those of you in Japan and India and other places that side of the planet, thanks for staying up late. I hope I make it worth it for you. And I'm glad your mics are muted so that if you fall asleep and you hit your head on your microphone, we don't all hear it. But anyway, I'm going to share my screen here and then we'll get started. And we'll do a Q&A session at the end. And I look forward to hearing questions, as well as you see my URL on the bottom of the page there. You'll be able to contact me anytime via the contact form there if you want. I am Tom Field. I was a contributing editor at Sky and Telescope magazine for about 10 years. But true confession here, I'm pretty much an idiot. I don't have a graduate degree, or to be honest, true confession, I don't even have an undergraduate degree. So what I want to show you tonight or today is the kinds of things that you can do to do science with your equipment. Now, if you don't have any equipment, that's okay too, because understanding what we're going to talk about will build a foundation to help you understand and grow in the literature and in your understanding of the stars and the life cycles. So this isn't this a gorgeous image? These are, you know, shock waves of just enormous power. And that I can witness, that all of us can witness these new stars being born during our short lifetime. It's really astonishing, isn't it? But what about all the other stars in this view? They were born ages ago, of course. Where are they in their life story? And how do we know that? How do we understand the life story of stars? Now, this colorful slide shows you an overview of the kinds of things we're going to be talking about today, where the stars, every star has a fingerprint spectrum. And we'll talk about how to create those spectrum and how you can do that with really simple, inexpensive equipment. But I'm going to stop screen sharing for one moment because I want to actually show you the technology here. So here I am in my office, no fancy backdrop like Christian has. I wish I did, but if I had a fancy backdrop, I couldn't show you this gas tube. So this is a helium gas tube, as it turns out. And this is a tool called a star analyzer. It's a grading, it costs about $200. You spend more on that on coffee at Starbucks, if you're a Starbucks person, or on one eyepiece. So this isn't expensive, what I'm talking about tonight. Many people think it is, and it used to be until the last 10 or 15 years. So my story, just really briefly about me, just so you get a sense for the progression that anybody can go through with this, is I wanted to do some science of the sort I just mentioned, where I understood a little bit more about what I was reading. And I got a grading like this, a diffraction grading it's called. I put it on my C8 right outside those windows here in Seattle, Washington, about 3 miles from Pike Place Market, if you know that locale. I went out at midnight, it was August. I captured, I've done about 6 images before that in my life. I wasn't much of an imager. I wasn't much of an observer, to be honest. I'd had my telescope for 10 or 20 years at this point. And I captured a video on a webcam with a lot of duct tape involved in getting things to go together. I came inside at midnight. As I said, it was Vega. My blue jeans had grass stains on the knees because, you know, it's Vega in the summer. So the next morning, Sunday morning, I tried to process that spectra and I ran into some trouble. And I'll talk a little bit more about that and how I got past that obstacle as we move on. But right now, what I'd like to show you is just this grading. It's 1.25-inch grading. And you can see when I put it in the light path, see all those colors there? that gold and the robin egg blue, all these different colors are the light from that hydrogen gas tube getting split just like going through a prism. This is how, whether it's amateurs or professionals, we create these colorful spectra that have so much information about the stars we're studying. So that's what we're going to do, is explore what we can do with spectra. So, you know, this chart is not one we're going to get into a lot of detail in, but I wanted to refer to this HR diagram because it's a map of our understanding of the stars. And in my opinion, it's the bedrock upon which we build our understanding. And where did that understanding come from? It came from centuries of giants climbing on each other's shoulders. What an analogy. I'd like to be at the top. I wouldn't like to be at the bottom, although you'd be making a contribution, but I really don't want to be out here. And to be honest, I'm probably way back there in some way far back row. So the point here is that in order to understand state of the art and the kinds of science that has evolved in the last 100 years, we need to talk a little bit about the history. It's helpful to understand that progression. And what you'll see is that amateurs, we can not only climb up here and look at the view, but we can help build this pyramid or whatever that column is called, and we can walk in their footsteps. Not just watch them walk and admire them up there, but we can take some of the same steps they did. So how can we learn more about the stars we love? Of course, there's tons of ways, especially with the web, to do this kind of learning. What I found is I'm not that good a student. I would read these things and they'd go in one ear and they'd go out the other. And my experience has been, and I'm going to come back to this again, my experience has been when you have a foundation and when your reading is based on something that you've done, on an image you've captured. For example, when you capture an image of the moon, there's craters there, which when you're observing visually, you go, yeah, there are some craters. Maybe you look one or two up. But when you've got that image in hand, you actually do a little bit more digging. And that digging is how we grow in our understanding. So let's look at some quick examples here. Again, here's our beloved Orion Nebula. And we're going to look at just the belt stars rotated around a little bit. There they are. And when we put a grating in line, we get these spectra, these rainbows, that's all they are. Now, this is a qualitative view. We're just looking at it for the beauty, which is considerable in itself. These are nature's colors. And hidden inside these rainbows is a lot about the biographies, the life of each star. So I mentioned the star analyzer and showed you an example a moment ago. I just want you, if you are interested in doing this kind of thing, to have you see how easy it is to mount. Because when I first got into this, I thought, you know, look, I don't really know much about back focus, focal length, or any of that. What's a remarkable thing is how easy it is to use a grating like this on almost any equipment. You can, if you're just a DSLR person, and a lot of great imaging gets done with DSLRs and visual as well as science like this, we have a little grating right here. In fact, let me right click here and just have PowerPoint keep the cursor visible. Now, I live in Seattle. Bill Gates is in the neighborhood. He lives in a sort of across the tracks over the lake. I sometimes want to go and knock on his door and ask him why I have to go through this pointer option every freaking time I start PowerPoint. Why can't it remember? So you can use a star analyzer on almost any camera, as I said, a FITS camera. We have an adapter for a T-ring if you want to put it on your telescope. You can use it on an astronomical video camera. And I'm going to show you some remarkable spectra that are done with that. And the reason I want to emphasize the video piece is because, you know, when we look in the back of the magazines that we all subscribe to or look at those astronomy pictures of the day, like, you know, who knows that, and God knows where Christian got that image behind him. But, you know, that Pleiades image. And we go, especially as beginners, we go, I want to do that. I want to see that kind of stuff. And then we find out that it, you know, you read the fine print underneath the image and it's 25 hours of imaging time. And, you know, it's a mountaintop telescope in Chile and it's some master guru like Christian doing the imaging and they got a 14-inch telescope. I don't have any of that. And I'm in Seattle. It's cloudy here a lot of the time. 20 hours of integration time. That could be months worth of clear skies that I'd require here in Seattle. So what I want to make a point of here is that the images and the spectra I'm going to show you tonight are all created in a matter of minutes, if not sub-seconds in video. So just one other example here, the ZWO series, of course, is very popular these days. I see so many of them. You can mount a grating in a filter wheel. And we'll talk a little bit more about the decisions you have to make to do that kind of thing. So let's look in a little more detail at this field in Perseus, which is visible year round, right? So let's zoom in. What do we have here? Now, as a devil's advocate, I'm going to say we have a boring star field, right? It's stars, it's points of light. They get in the way of the deep sky imaging that we want to do, right? They're just points of light. Occasionally, there's a little different color here. But as I mentioned earlier, each of these stars has their own story to tell us. And we're going to look at these three stars just picked out of the sky, picked carefully because they illustrate some interesting things. But let's take a look at this field when captured with just a DSLR. Simple telescope and tracking. There's those three stars again, and we see some spectra here. And these spectra have some features. Notice that there's some gaps here and here, and there's some bright spots. That's where the real details are. And we'll talk a little bit about the science tonight. And basically, these gaps are fingerprints that help us identify the composition and other physical properties of the star. Now, you don't have to be a quantum scientist, Brian Cox, or you don't have to be a PhD in physics. You don't have to even know how these lines are created. The beautiful thing about what we're doing here is that once you have that foundation, you can explore whatever areas interest you. And if you're interested in the quantum physics behind these lines that you've captured with your equipment, more power to you. So I want to spend just a moment here talking about mapping. We have a map here, right? It's a one-dimensional map. It's star temperatures. We're more or less familiar with this, that the cool stars are over here and the hot stars are over here. There's the temperatures. But I want to tell you a story. I was going to make it a story about myself, but that wouldn't be truthful. It was my wife. About 15 years ago, she was in the car following on her Garmin, right? Pre-iPhone. She was following some directions on her Garmin to some strip mall, right? Some, for those of you who aren't in the US, strip mall doesn't mean what you might think it means. It means a small mall. Doesn't have anything to do with clothing or absence. So she followed the directions. You know, it said turn left here. Maybe there was a little map, turn right. She did her business there. She got back in the car. She pulled out and ready to turn onto the street. And this is a true story. She told me later, she didn't know which way to turn. She wasn't using her Garmin. She didn't know how she got to where she was. So she didn't know whether home was left or right or where her next stop was. She didn't know any of that. And the reason I mention that is that maps, two-dimensional maps, help us navigate. These days, most of us, we jump to a star. We may know a little bit about where it's in the sky. Of course, our telescopes do all the work these days. But a map helps us understand so that we can get from place to place. And that's what this diagram is. This diagram has temperature across the bottom, as we saw. And in this dimension, it's just brightness. And you can see stars, for example, these cool stars, most of them aren't very bright. Some are very bright. So let's go back to this image here and look at this star first. When we look at the gaps and identify the type of star this is, it's a cool type M star, which makes it over here. It's pretty simple to identify the type of star. This turns out to be a red giant, a super giant. It's like Betelgeuse. It's a cool star, But notice it's not down here in brightness. It's way up here because it's enormous in size. It's not hot, but there's a lot of it to light up the sky. So, and I mentioned earlier about maps and this being a map. Once we have appreciation and have captured data and know about a star in this quadrant, in this region of this map, then as we go on to read about it, we have a conceptual place to put that understanding. We have a way of relating that understanding to the understanding of the next star that we look at. We can understand something about the life cycle. Now, if you're not familiar with this chart, again, there's a little bit of reading on the web will get you to where you need to be. Notice here, for example, this is the sun and other stars also. Let's go back to our view here. So we've seen this is a cool star by its lines or gaps. What about this star? So this star has one bright spot, not a gap. What's that about? Well, this is a hot star. It's a B star, a very hot star, but notice that little E there. That E stands for emission lines. It has a circumstellar disk. I love circumstellar. I feel like an adult when I say that word. That circumstellar disk is glowing from the very hot ultraviolet light coming out of that star. And that disk creates that little peak in hydrogen. So once again, we can use the HR diagram. It's a B star. And we'll look a little bit about how we classify stars in a moment with our equipment. It's a hotter star. So it's up somewhere in this region. So now we have a relationship between these two. And the final example on this screen is down here. And it's really very different as we can see. Down here, we can see a lot of bright spots. Again, I use sort of a vernacular, common language when I say bright spot. The technical term would be an emission line or an emission feature. So what are those about? Well, this is what's called a Wolf-Rayet star. There's an image of it. It's like 25 times the size of the sun. And we're seeing the bare core. It has intense stellar winds. How do I know this? Because once I captured a spectrum like this, I went and read about it. And for the first time in my life, I remembered it. You know, maybe you're like me and have read about Wolf-Rayet stars over the years. But when you have the data in your hands, as I mentioned, things begin to stick and you are more motivated. And in this case, it's a relatively late stage star. And this outer shell has been dissipated by intense stellar winds. Remember that stars burn the elements, starting with hydrogen and helium and all the way up to iron. And what we're seeing in this shell are some of those elements that were created by the stellar process. So we're seeing glowing lines of hydrogen, helium, mostly helium, nitrogen, oxygen. It's very different looking than those other spectra we saw. So this is an overview, just in one star field, just three stars of the different types of stars that we can see. And this stars, these Wolf-Rayet stars, they can be anywhere from this temperature to literally way, way up here off the chart. They're very hot stars. And in many cases, they end up being a supernova and end up as white dwarfs. And as I said, once we've captured this kind of data, we're not going to read all this screen, but this is the kind of information, whether it's Wikipedia or elsewhere, that we can, again, read more about. And just this morning, again, I was brushing up on Wolf-Rayet stars for this presentation. Just this morning, I saw this article here about exploding stars, first exploding stars of their kind, spectroscopic analysis. You know, there's the spectrum curve we'll be looking at in a moment. All of this begins to come together in a well-stitched understanding of the star. So I want to talk just a minute or two, a little bit about the history and the science, just to get us to the same level. If you're familiar with all of this, bear with me. We're going to get into a lot of concrete, practical examples of the kinds of things you can do in just a moment. So get my mouse over here. Of course, Sir Isaac Newton was said to be the first person to split light with a prism into its component colors. And you can see the prism there. We can also split light by bouncing it off of a finely lined surface or as you saw in my little demo with a star analyzer grating. I'm going to turn that gas tube off because they don't last that long. So now, after Newton, there were a variety of people who looked at spectra, but really it was Bunsen who began to look at things in an orderly manner. He would burn things, burn samples. He was a pyromaniac. He burned everything he could get his hands on. And then he put the light through a prism and he looked at the result. And the great thing is he cataloged everything that he looked at, all of those spectra. And those spectra looked like this. And you can see, as we saw earlier, that we have different elements with, it's like forensics, right? It's like, if you're familiar with the CSI TV show, we're doing forensics here on these stars, looking at their fingerprints. Now, we've named some of these lines so that we can talk about them with Greek letters. For example, this hydrogen beta line, what color would we call that? Let's call it, for those of you who are familiar with it. Now, I know I spoke to a group in Brazil the other day. They weren't familiar with robins, the bird. But in many, many areas, there's these robins that have this egg. It's this color, robin egg blue. That's our hydrogen beta. Let's call it that. Now, again, we're not going to get into a lot of detail here, but I wanted to show you just that each element, again, just to reiterate, each element has its own fingerprint. And for example, there's that robin egg blue hydrogen beta line in hydrogen. It doesn't exist at all over here in helium. So this is a poster I created some years ago. I'm particularly proud of the fact that Neil deGrasse Tyson told me that he has it hanging on his office wall. That's pretty cool. Now, it might sound like I'm on a first name basis with Neil, you know, and I was having coffee and he said, oh, by the way, Tom, I wanted to tell you. But the fact is, I stood out in the rain for 3 hours here in Seattle one night while he was giving a lecture. On the sidewalk I stood. When he came out, I had the poster, I showed it to him, and he asked for it, so I gave it to him. And then 2 years later, I did the same thing, and he told me. But I'll tell you an interesting quick thing about him. We've got a lot of ground to cover, so I don't want to spend too much on these kinds of stories. But the first time I met him, I had a manila folder with some spectra that I'm going to show you in just a minute, of quasars, supernovae. People were queued up on the sidewalk. He was autographing things. He was a celebrity. When I got there and I said, Dr. Tyson, I have high school students capturing the spectra of quasars. It was like I flipped a switch. He was no longer a celebrity. He was a scientist. And he wanted to talk. He wanted to hear. In fact, he asked me a question. It didn't make much sense to me the first time I heard it. He said, what are you packing? I went, what? I beg your pardon? He said, what's the aperture of your telescopes? And I told him, people do this with 6- and 8-inch telescopes. And that really got his attention. So it was fun to see him as a scientist. And believe me, he's every bit as friendly and kind and generous as we've seen him on TV. Now, if he would just tweet out my poster to his 13 million followers on Twitter, then that would be a good thing, wouldn't it? Okay, so the photographs I've shown of amateurs up until now in this presentation, what do they all have in common? They're old, white men. People who don't fit in that category haven't had the opportunities. And I wanted to show you some of them because I think the recognition is important. Nancy Grace Cannon and her team called computers more than 100 years ago, believe it or not, were prohibited from accessing the telescopes at NASA, at Harvard. So they ended up analyzing the spectroscopic plates, the photographic plates, and they analyzed, it's hard to believe, hundreds, like 400,000 or 500,000 of these plates. And they just, with all that data and with the insight and knowledge that they brought to it over time, they ended up coming up with a star classification system, which is very important to our understanding of stars. So Priyamvada Nataraja is at Yale. Our Indian friends here tonight, I hope I've pronounced her name right. She studies black holes. Nancy Grace Roman down on the lower left there. She was the first astronomer at NASA in the late 1940s. Imagine the challenge of doing that as a woman then. And she really was a big fan and proponent and helped make the Hubble Space Telescope happen. So Dr. Quintana here studies cooler stars like type M stars that have exoplanets around them, perhaps with some life. We don't know, of course. And Dr. Eisler here is at Dartmouth, and she studies gravitational lensing. These are just a handful of examples of some of the people these days who are beginning to get recognition, which has long been absent in the field. So, and I thought it was important that we just spend a moment looking at this and acknowledging these issues. Okay, so we've had some history, some theory, some equipment. I know you're all sitting there. You're like, I don't know if I can show you on my screen, drill, you know, like going, okay, Tom, come on, you know, enough arm waving. What can we actually do with our equipment? So I want to show you some really amazing examples. If we take the star analyzer grating, we put it in the light path, we get a rainbow which falls on our camera sensor, and we can analyze that. Now, this next slide is going to be a series of spectra captured at different times. This was done by Torsten Hansen with an imaging source video camera. That's the kind of short exposures that are required. Of course, the stars are bright. You know, there's so many bright stars that are local, literally 5, 10, 15,000. So we don't need that long integration time to get interesting scientific results. Now, each of these, as I said, is a different star type and a different spectrum going from hot to cool. So our cool stars are down here, hot stars here. Here's a type A star like Vega. We're not going to spend a lot of time. There is a lot of science to be had on this screen, but I wanted to show you just one or two things. The first is, notice that these cool stars at the bottom have these bands, not just single lines, whole bands on these type M stars over here. What are those? A cooler star can have an actual molecule in its atmosphere. It's cool enough that it doesn't get burned up. This molecule in this case is titanium oxide. And to be honest, that's all I know about it. You want to know more? Have at it. I'm like a really broad, wide river, but not very shallow. Occasionally I do deep dives, but you don't have to. And the reason I harp on that is because I want to eliminate the obstacle to your getting started, which is that thought in your head that says, I'm not smart enough to do this. You are. If I am, you are, trust me. So these cool stars have bands, as I showed you. So what about this feature here? I wanted to show you that one between the lines. Notice that that one is the darkest on this type A star, but it doesn't even exist down here. If I could draw, I might be an artist. Clearly, I'm not that either. So these cool stars don't even have that line. What is this? What color is this? That's, shall we say, oh, that's robin egg blue. That's our hydrogen beta line. And this type A star has the strongest one. Why would that be? A really quick science review for you. And that is from the Bohr model, we have atoms with electrons that are going around in different orbital shells. And those shells are numbered. And when electrons jump from shell to shell, they absorb energy. And when they jump from 2 to 4, they make this line here, the hydrogen beta line. And that's what we're seeing. These stars are dimmer in this area because they're too hot. The electrons, some of them just go right past that shell 4. And why aren't there any here? Because the stars aren't hot enough to pump those electrons up to that shell 4. So that's all the atomic physics we're going to do tonight. And I just love this slide because it shows how we can use spectra to determine different temperatures of stars. Now, my wife tells me always I need to dress for success. I don't think this is what she means. In fact, I'm sure it's not. And, you know, you can see the hydrogen beta region up there in the alpha in the red, right? So, but this is a slide, it's a great overview. And I wanted to show you just one quick thing on this slide. And that is sometimes we have a rainbow with gaps, and sometimes we have a relatively dark area with bright spots, right? Which we get depends on things we won't talk about tonight, but it has to do with the temperature of the gases involved and things, Kirchhoff laws. But we'll see examples of both of these. But the interesting thing about them is that whether it's a gap or a line, they appear at the same place. So that hydrogen beta line that we saw a minute ago, that's either going to be a gap or a line, but it'll always be at the same spot. Okay, so now suppose the Hubble Space Telescope people made a huge mistake and they gave me time on the Hubble Space Telescope and I captured this spectrum and I thought I saw here a little dimming. I don't know if you can see that on your screens. And I wrote a paper and said, yeah, I saw a little dimming in the robin egg blue region. It's not going to get published, right? So in order to do science, we have to be quantitative. And to do that, we plot the intensity of that rainbow, of that spectrum. And that's a typical plot. So this is, in this case, this axis here is intensity. So this peak is high because, well, the star is really bright. Some of the light goes right through the grating and shows up here. And this area over here, well, it's sort of dim out here on the wings, right? So these areas are low, but again, my drawing skills need to be improved. But notice that that minor, maybe discernible dimming becomes a really clear dip here. So that means we're quantitative. Now we can compare spectra across telescopes, across stars, across days, and actually do science. Now, how do we get that graph? Now, I mentioned earlier, I went out that first night and I captured a spectrum. And this is literally it. I'm going to show you the video from that webcam in just a minute. And then I tried to create this graph and I failed. Sunday morning, I was at my computer. I went upstairs, I'm in the basement. I went upstairs a few minutes afternoon, had spent all morning at it. And I told my wife, I quit, I give up. And literally I took the box, I put it in the box, and I put it in that drawer right down behind me. And I said to her, I'm supposed to be having fun. This is not fun, I'm struggling. The software was freeware, it was in French. Not only would it crash, but to add injury, or insult to injury, the error messages when it crashed were in French. So I gave up. But it kept bothering me over the next couple of weeks. I finally decided, okay, I'm just going to write something to create this intensity graph off of that image. And, you know, Saturday morning I worked, Sunday or Monday I was done. And now, 10 or 20,000 programming hours later, I'm almost done. My wife keeps saying, would you finish the software so that we can have dinner at a decent hour and the same hour every night? I said I was an idiot, but the one thing, I'm not as dumb as I look, but the one thing I do know that is if I give you a software demo now that's longer than 2 minutes, you're going to be sleeping. You're going to be like starting to, you know, cruise YouTube. So let's go really quickly. This is the star and the spectrum from that first night out. Now I used a color camera, but like in visual imaging, color isn't as sensitive, but it's really easy and great for outreach. When you show newcomers this rainbow, they go, oh, look, that's a rainbow, as opposed to a mono image. So all you do is bracket in the region that you want to study with these lines. And over here, you get that intensity graph. So there's the star. Again, that's the intensity from that. And this spectrum here is over here. So in fact, let's zoom in on that just for a moment. I know the clock's ticking. I'm only going to be at this for 2 minutes if I pull it off. Over here, if we zoom in, there's a gap there maybe. There's a gap there. I think there might be something here in the robin egg blue, do you think? So over here, see that dip in intensity? That's that gap right there. But there's lots of dips, aren't there? So what? Now what? So remember I mentioned that Bunsen burnt everything and cataloged everything. We can use that catalog and descendants from that catalog to identify those absorption features. Let's pop it up, it's in the software. I'm just gonna say to the software, show me with an overlay on the graph where the hydrogen lines would be. And would you look at that? There's a dip there. That one matches. That one matches. These are the hydrogen lines. There's that hydrogen beta right in the robin egg blue all the way down. So we've now fairly conclusively demonstrated that Vega, captured on an 8-inch telescope in downtown Seattle, first night out with a star analyzer grating, we can detect the hydrogen bomber series of that star. That's pretty amazing. This is actually a video. I'll play the video just for a second so you see it jump around. My seeing was varying here. Look how big my star is. And you can see the spectrum jumping around too. So we're going to stop the demo here. But I would, if I could ask you, if you would just sort of keep this, if I can get it right, so much for PowerPoint, right? Keep that region in your mind's eye, right? Because I'm going to come back to it in a little bit and I'd like you to see it again. So let me go like this, come back to my PowerPoint show. There we are. We just talked about how to create that graph. Let's look at a really quick example here, an overview type example. Now, Christian had the Pleiades, right? The seven plus or minus one sister showing. There they are. And there's a telescope view. And there's the spectrum. Now, this is a qualitative view. This was done with like a point and shoot, not even a DSLR. It's pretty in its own right. But I want to look at a higher resolution image actually done with a camera that can understand what it's seeing, if you forgive me that term. So again, thanks, Bill Gates. Let's get these pointers set. I don't think I'd be able to get close to his house if I went over and knocked on his door and asked him, why didn't they make this a sticky option? Notice that each star in Pleiades has its own intensity graph of its spectrum. That's all I wanted to show you on this graph or on this screen. There's a dip here. There's an absorption feature here. This is that life story that I was talking about. And as you saw, you can do it in the software. This is a hydrogen gas tube. There's the hydrogen alpha. There's the robin egg blue beta. And just if you're an educator, we also have a little handheld spectrometer, which I could wave in front of you, but there's a picture of it for gas tubes. It's very popular in classrooms. Lots of universities and high schools, homeschools have it. It's pretty cool. Now, one thing I know that a lot of you do, and I want to thank you for, is the outreach that you do. And this is a wonderful outreach activity. This is in Marseille. Now, you wouldn't want to do this at a dark sky site, would you? But when you show this kind of thing to people, you really are taking the next step in understanding and explaining and sharing the wonder of what humanity has managed to understand about the stars. One interesting thing I found here in the US, when I show this and start talking about spectroscopy to people, many of them will go, oh yeah, was that the third or fourth episode of the Cosmos series by Tyson? So Tyson's work really has gotten through. So let's look at our beloved Ring Nebula. There's its spectrum. And you can see there's just two images there because this ring is made up of really only two elements that are glowing, hydrogen alpha and oxygen. So most extended objects aren't interesting in a star analyzer grading. And now I've lost it on my desk, so I'm not going to be able to wave it in front of you anymore. So you're saved from that. So, but let's look at the spectrum of, again, this is of course a late stage star, right? It's at the end of its life. Let's look at, first of all, the kind of equipment you would need to do what I'm about to show you in this next slide. Considerably more expensive, higher resolution, harder to use. Nobody starts with these. It's just too big a first step. It's a big investment if you're not sure you want to do it either. You know, this gets hot after a while, so I'm going to remove it. Let's look at a slit spectra at the other end of the life cycle. This is right, the Orion Nebula, the birthplace of stars. There's some hydrogen, there's some oxygen. This is an extended object, very extended. So it does require a slit spectrometer. So, you know, it's fun to remember before you understood something. I'd like you to, for a moment, just think about the first time you saw M42. Now, in a smaller group, I might ask for people to describe that experience. we don't have the time, and we have so many people here tonight. Thank you so much today. That that won't be possible. But my experience was, it was in the early 90s. Shoemaker Levy was coming. I wanted to get a telescope. I heard that the astronomy club was doing a first quarter star party in Denver. I drove down. I got out of my car. I walked up on the 10, maybe 3 meter berm, and looked down on the observing field. And what did I see? Now, you know, have you been to the circus and seen those cannons that shoot men and women into the air? That's what I thought I was seeing. Of course they were Dobbs, but I didn't know any better. But I was excited. I didn't want to be shot out of a cannon, but I walked out onto the field. There were people much like many of you. Thank you for the outreach you do. That giving nourishes our heart as well as gives back and helps everybody grow. I queued up at a Dob. There was somebody much like many of you running the Dob, talking about birthplace of stars. And I was excited. And I got to the eyepiece and I was really disappointed, honestly. It was a smudge, right? It was a little cloudy smudge. Now, I still go back and look at M42, sometimes in the city. My point here is, and you probably do too, why would we go back and look at it? Well, since that first time we saw it, we have learned so much as amateurs about M42, that it's a stellar nursery, it's the birthplace of stars. When we bring that understanding to the eyepiece and to our reading, our experience is that much richer. And that's what spectroscopy has done for me, is allowed me to grow in ways I didn't expect. Now, the other reason, of course, that M42 is more interesting to us now as more experienced amateurs is we have better telescopes, we go to dark sky sites, and we know how to use averted vision, right? We know how to look out of our peripheral vision so that we can see the stars with a more sensitive part of our eyes. Okay, what about Uranus and Neptune? There's the spectra. Look at those deep gaps in the spectrum, graphed and visible there. Now, again, these are relatively cool objects. So molecules don't get incinerated like they do most of the time on stars. So what we're seeing here is the methane atmosphere on these planets. This is also done by Torsten Hansen with a video camera and an 8-inch Newtonian. You can do this with a 4-inch telescope or a 6-inch telescope. Refractor doesn't matter. Has to be well corrected if it's a refractor. So to observe the atmosphere of a planet, think a professional astronomer 50 or 60 years ago would have given their left leg, right, to be able to do that. Today we have telescopes like the JWT telescope that's going to be observing these absorption features on exoplanets and help us study and understand those planets. And that's likely the way, if we ever do, that we'll discover ET. ET probably won't have two eyes. Maybe that would be stunning in itself to learn. But whether it's some, you know, little microscopic unicellular organism, if it's breathing, if it's creating gases, we're going to see evidence of that spectroscopically. That's why by our doing this rudimentary work as amateurs, we are more able to understand what the professionals do going forward. Okay, so let's skip that slide and listen. In what, 1881, Henry Draper observed the spectrum of a comet. Heck, if Hank can do it, so can we. Now, I love, there it is. This is done, and as you'll see here on the left, with just, what does it say there on the bottom? Oh, a Canon, just a Canon camera on an 80 millimeter refractor. Look at that colorful string of gems there. And of course, over here, we can see the intensity peaks of the Swan bands. This was done by Vikram Agnihotri. He's in Rajasthan. Now, a quick story about Vikrant. When he first came to me in 2013 or 2010, he was a newcomer and he wanted to buy the software. And I thought, I've been to India. I love visiting India. But I thought, he's a poor Indian man. I'll give them a big discount. I don't usually give discounts, sometimes to students. And I know my email is going to be flooded now. I'm a student, give me a discount. But I gave him the discount. Now, the cool thing is, over the next 10 years, he grew well beyond my knowledge. I tutored him, and what teacher doesn't like their student to get better? And he did. But he sent me a photograph of his equipment a year ago. He's got this, like, it's a C14 or something, some expensive Paramount mount. So no more discounts for Vikram. But I love this spectrum because even though it's an expanded non-compact object, it's compact enough in the core that we can see this spectrum. So there's an example of the sodium lines on NEOWISE a little more recently. So this is a slide I really love to see. Anybody who uses a C-clamp on their equipment is my kind of observer, right? So this was captured by Robin Leadbeater. And what he did was he put a star analyzer on a video camera and spent a fair amount of time photographing or recording the sky and captured the spectrum down in the lower corner here of that meteor. There is the spectrum. Right there is a brightening, an outburst, a bolide of some sort, and there is the spectrum. Now, listen, if spectroscopy is a niche activity, then meteor spectroscopy is what a niche in a niche, right? But again, for some people, they love this kind of thing. We're not going to talk a lot about the sun. Those of us in North America have heard a lot about it and will be again. But during a total eclipse, you can capture the spectra of the sun. For myself, to be honest, I was in Wyoming some years ago for the total eclipse. And I was going to record the spectrum. And then I decided I didn't want to play with equipment. I wanted to enjoy the majesty of it. But again, this kind of thing can be automated and there's lots to be seen. A quick review. We have a couple more examples and then we'll finish up. Doppler shift, you may be familiar with this, but it's again, the pitch change that, for example, a train going through a station with its whistle on, right? High as it's coming towards you, low as it's moving away. Same thing happens. Well, for example, here we can see it graphically illustrated. Standing behind the car, the waves are going to be further apart, as if stretched and compressed or higher pitched close to the car, or if you're in the front. Here's the spectrum. The same thing happens with light as happens with sound. So if we were expecting this triplet, great term, self-defining more or less, this triplet, I guess musicians use that term. I hadn't thought of that before. But instead of seeing it right here between yellow going into green, we saw it way over here. That shift to the right would mean that object is moving away from us. Or if we saw it over here, that would mean the object is coming towards us. Let's look at how we use Doppler shift to understand some amazing things. Now, many of us are familiar with the concept and the idea of supernovas, stars at the end of their lives that blow up. There's different types. This will be the quickest description of the type 1A that you've ever heard. Two stars orbiting each other. One is bigger than the other. Some of the gas from one star ends up on the other and it blows up fast, right? You want to know more? You can read about it. You're catching my drift now in terms of my approach to knowledge. I don't want any of us to be intimidated and think that I have to understand everything about supernovae in order to study the spectrum of the supernova. So here is a supernova in M101. There's a photograph of another supernova from about 500-600 years ago, locally in our galaxy. You can see there's some structure there, right? It sort of looks like a sphere. So David Strange captured this spectrum with a C9 in less than 15 minutes of integration time. So we're getting into longer exposures now. But one thing that, since I'm talking about exposure, that I wanted to mention, I think one of the biggest challenges all of us have in imaging these days is that light pollution is really cutting into our observing time, right? The good news, and I'm not exaggerating here, is that spectra are much, much less impacted by urban light pollution or the moon. Why is that? Well, when we're doing visual imaging, we're really interested in those beautiful gradients, right? The colored gradients or the just intensity gradients. When we're doing science, We just need to see those dips and peaks. In fact, we don't do all that fancy post-processing. We might do stacking or darks or flats, but we don't do any of the stretching or convolutions that we can do with visual imaging, excuse me, because we want the data not to be different than the way it hit our sensor. So here is a graph of the intensity of that spectrum, and see that deep dip? Well, now this next slide will not be on the final exam, but each type of supernova has a different spectrum fingerprint. And type 1A supernovae have a deep dip just above 6,000 that's silicon. So just above 6,000 is that deep dip. We can identify this as a type 1A supernova by that dip. And I'm going to do just a quick piece of science here that you should be excited by. How fast is a supernova shell expanding towards us? Couple numbers. There's a division, subtraction, and an addition. So first of all, what wavelength is that? Well, that's 6150. So let's make a note of that. Now, if Bunsen had burnt beach sand, silicon, he would have found that dip at a stationary object at that wavelength. So I couldn't remember the Doppler shift formula. In fact, I had to look it up just the other day. Look, there's not a lot of math here, is there? We plug those numbers in, and we now have measured the speed, blue shift, with which that shell is coming towards us. There should be, to be honest, several wows there. One is, wow, that is fast. The other is, wow, I can't believe I've measured that on a backyard telescope in less than 15 minutes. It's really remarkable. This isn't something that just people like David Strange do. Lots of people do this, but these are dimmer than most stars, so it does take a little bit of integration time. Now, Adam Riess, he won the Nobel Prize, of course, some years ago for work they did before the turn of the century on the cosmological expansion, accelerating. And what did they use for standard candles? Many of you will know that they use type 1A supernovae. And in fact, amateurs can participate in the process of helping to identify supernovae type using this kind of approach. So what about the spectrum of a black hole? Now, if I have time, I'll come back, because he actually criticized some of the work I did. It's hard to believe that I got to his attention, but if we have time, I'll mention him, Adam Riess. So keep him in mind. Does a black hole have a spectrum? Well, the black hole itself doesn't, that we can measure, but what about the accretion disk as it spirals in? It gets very hot and very bright. So there's 3C273, you know that, you spot it there, right? I couldn't. David Hayworth captured this image in Portland, Oregon. There's C3273, there's the spectrum. Notice the two little points of light at the top of those arrows on the right. There they are, and there's the spectrum. Now, this guy, Martin Schmidt, was 25 years old in 1963 when he saw this spectrum for the first time. First time it was captured. He was a good scientist. He had an unknown. So he thought, I'll compare it to things I know and see if I can find a match. So he said, let's look at the hydrogen bomber lines. This is the screen I asked you to keep in your mind's eye from my software. There's where the bomber lines should be. And he observed, he didn't use my software. He said, look, there's no match, is there? There's no lines above these on this spectrum that line up. So he initially concluded, there's no hydrogen on this object, whatever it is. But there was, and he figured it out. Enormous redshift, enormous redshift. This object was so bright that even though it was 2 billion light years away, calculated by this kind of observation, that we could still see it, enormous distance away. So this is one of the most luminous quasars known. It's the brightest to us. And Martin Schmidt, there's a beautiful account of his discovering of it. I've got it on the site and I can send you a link to it if you email me. There's a contact form on our site. But he describes in an interview, it's a transcript, how scared he was when he first saw this data with that redshift. He was afraid he was making a stupid mistake. The same kind of imposter complex that we all have. Even the rank beginner feels they're an imposter compared to other people further along in the field, as well as the professionals. He went home that night and he said to his wife, I thought this was interesting. He said, something terrible happened at work today. She said, what? He told her he'd made this discovery and he was worried that he was going to become a celebrity and it was going to keep him from his work. Now today, of course, people typically, scientists do, but most people don't shy away from celebrity. We're saturated with celebrities, aren't we? All he wanted to do was to do science. I love it. What's amazing to me is this light, shall we say, to coin an expression, it's 2 billion light years old, right? It's that old, but we can still tease out data with an amateur telescope and understand something about the way this distant object was 2 billion years ago. It's as if that light didn't age. Humans, unfortunately, age a little differently. Here's Martin Schmidt a few years ago. He recently passed away. People accuse me of throwing him under the bus, and they're right. You know, he's got a full head of hair. I'm jealous of the guy. Okay, I just want to point out, so this came to me this morning, literally. It's a spectroscopy magazine, and here is a student studying the spectrum of a Seyfert galaxy, an AGN. There's an example of this on the samples page of my site, but it was very timely. And again, to be able to measure the recession velocity. In fact, I described this, to come back to it just briefly, we got to finish up. Christian's going to shoot me if I don't shut up. So I included this in my first Sky and Telescope article in 2010. And I described this as Doppler shift. Remember that guy, Adam Riess, I mentioned a few minutes ago. He was about to win the Nobel Prize when the editor-in-chief at Sky and Telescope sent him my article and said, Tom's calling this Doppler shift, is it? And Adam Riess, he replied and said, Tom's wrong. Future Nobel Prize winner that he was. He said, it's not Doppler shift because nothing is moving. What? Nothing's moving? What about all that shift? He went on to explain, of course, that this was cosmological expansion. Nothing is moving. We may be getting further apart. And that's quite a concept. And it's the kind of concept that you begin to play with as you capture data like this. So far we've been looking at things that are about how wide, about 50 angstroms. If we want to zoom in, I wish we could just take our mouse and zoom in, but it's empty magnification, right? Like putting more magnification on the moon, not possible. At some point, you don't get any more data. But with a slit spectrometer, we can observe the hydrogen alpha feature of Vega and compare it to the moon that's not moving appreciably back and forth, and we can detect the Doppler shift and the radial velocity of that object. Now, I have one final example, and then we'll finish up. Measuring the rotational speed of a star. That's hydrogen alpha. Now I have a, excuse me, I have a visual aid here. This is a star. Christian, nod your head. Can you see this completely? Okay, thanks. This edge is coming towards you. So that light is blue shifted. This edge is coming away from you, moving away from you. So this is red shifted. If it's spinning very quickly, that will change the light. And how does it change it? Well, the approaching edge is going to be blue shifted and the receding edge is red shifted. And there's Altair that's spinning very quickly. So with a slit spectrometer, not a star analyzer, but with a slit spectrometer, you can actually measure the rotational speed of a star. We really are standing on the shoulders of giants. I think you agree that we knuckle dragging naked apes, hairless apes, have figured out a way to look up at those twinkling objects and understand so much about them. How do you get started? I hope I've interested you in doing some of this. Well, you need a diffraction grating, as I said, $200. You can get all this at our site. You need a camera. Almost any camera works. You saw video, cooled fits, DSLR, doesn't matter, color, mono. You need software. This is the freeware I mentioned. I'm friends with those people. It's improved a lot over the years, and they're real leaders in the industry who were early adopters in this industry. They don't do much star analyzer work anymore. And there's advantages and disadvantages to freeware. And finally, you may need some spacers to adjust this distance a little bit. And I work with you if you're interested to make sure that you've got things set up right. There are tons of books out there. I'm not going to get into a lot of detail. They're linked to on our site. Books here, this one in particular is really a great one. But there's also some Patrick Moore ones here. Notice I say very little math. You don't need to be a math guy or a math gal to do this kind of thing. This book is particularly helpful because it has lots of samples. Believe me, I don't know why nitrogen would be in the spectrum of Seyfert galaxy, but the book I just showed you, he does, and we can use his knowledge. In fact, I just have to wave the book in front of you. It's not cheap, but it's a great book. Lots of examples and lots of text. Aimed at you, aimed at me, not aimed at a professional, so it's understandable. Okay. There's, of course, these days, forums. We've got a very active forum, lots of people there who want to help on our site. I wanted to mention the AAVSO has jumped really big into spectroscopy, starting with Arnie years ago, and then Stella as executive director, both professional astronomers, as is the new executive director. They have a spectra database that professionals access, as well as the database that they've had for years. And this is a place that you can contribute to science. Not as much, to be honest, as I hope in coming years, but I think the professional community, what do we offer? We offer telescope time. Yeah, there's airborne and mountaintop telescopes, but you can't get time on a telescope like that to do the studies, longitudinal studies. Look at how things are changing. We can, and we're happy to. And this, the professional community has known that with reference to photometry in the AAVSO for years. By the way, so on my site is a video, YouTube video link. I did a hour-long workshop, hands-on workshop for the AAVSO members. About 100 of them attended. You can download the software for free from my site for 30 days. You can download the sample data I used in that AAVSO workshop, and you can watch that YouTube video, hopefully on a second screen, and you can go through the workshop. Even if you never plan to do this with a telescope of your own, once you've gone through an hour-long workshop, you'll have it in your gut. So, as I said, there's opportunities for professional contributions. These are all amateurs, except for Bob Stenzel. So there are lots of opportunities and more coming. So we talked about a little bit about the HR diagram here. We saw early on the spectrum of a supergiant like Betelgeuse that was very cool. We came over here and we looked at a BE star up here. We looked at a Wolf-Rayet star that might end up as a white dwarf. This is our map to the life cycle of stars. And it's a map that when you actually have visited some of those points with your own data, this map becomes much more helpful and informative. So you're not like my wife in the parking lot trying to figure out which way to turn. You'll have a conceptual framework, spatial in your mind, that connects all the different star types. We've come a long way in the last hour. Christian, please don't shoot me for going over. We've come a long way in the last 200 or 300 years. The giants who came before us, many of whom are unknown and will always be unknown, have just done amazing things in so many fields, including astronomy. I'd like to thank you all for your attention. As I hope, if nothing else, you appreciate how much I love the field and how much I love people getting started. I will do everything I can, and there's a lot I can do to help you, sending me sample images, I can process them here, I can coach you on all sorts of things. I wish I was such a big company that I didn't have time for that. But to be honest, I'm glad I do, because it's what nourishes me and I love to be able to help. So don't hesitate to reach out to me and contact me. And with that, I will shut up, Christian. Have at it.